To lose one parent is a tragedy. To lose both is utter carelessness. So it's a euphemism. And he died, Frank died, in July. And he wrote Angela's Ashes in 1996. And he had just retired a year or so before from a teaching in the New York City high school system. And I always knew he was a good writer, a wonderful writer. And I urged him for years to write a book. Now I didn't know what he was going to call it. We were very good friends. We wrote a play together called A Couple of Blaguards, which we performed. We talked to each other on a daily basis. And he was, when my father left, although Frank was only 10, he actually took over then as the pater familias, the father of the family. And he was good, looked after us all, even though I was only a year, a month, and a day younger. But I always, and he was smaller than me, but he was the only smaller person that I ever looked up to and all his life. And so he was a good friend, decent guy, great sense of humor, extraordinary intellect, and loved passing on his knowledge. All his students adored him because he had the advantage of having no formal education, in the sense that he left school like I did at the age of 13, and he went back when he was 22, and somehow or another faked his way into New York University and got himself a degree after being on probation, and then became a teacher. So he wasn't circumscribed by ordinary thinking about teaching. If a teacher loves what she is teaching, or he is teaching, as the case may be, then you pass that on, the love of it, rather than punishment. Oh, we have a test. This is what they're always doing with children, testing. Now, children don't need testing, they need loving. And that was Frank's idea. Love them. Love what you're talking about. Love the words. There was an Irish poet named John Millington Synge said, words, particularly in a play, should have the texture of a crisp autumn apple. That's the way I think of it. I think that's the way Frank thought about it too. Yeah, there was the part in where we grew up, having a father desert you was shameful. So you felt ashamed of not having a father. Other kids talked about their fathers. And their fathers supported them, their fathers looked after them, and their fathers stood up for them. And we had nobody ever to do that for us. And so, now here's the odd thing about, not odd, but being alcoholic, I was not a good father in my first marriage. I was about as, although there's ways of deserting a family without leaving physically. I was deserted in my head. So I was always out, I was always in the saloons, always drinking, always messing about. But when I was with the kids, I was they always said they enjoyed me. That's what it was. Because being a kid myself, I love playing. And I love playing with words and making up things and riddles and songs and not afraid of being silly in public. So they liked that. But it wasn't really being a father. So that was, and then when we divorced, I mean, there was the visitation stuff. But I think in the second marriage, we have two kids and a stepdaughter. And then the other two, I sort of cemented relationships with my kids from the first marriage. So now I get along, more than get along. I have a good relationship with all of them. And there are grandchildren. And I think they think well of me. I hope they do anyway. And if they don't, well, of course, there's nothing I can do about it. But and it won't be what they want for trying. There are, I think that 45 years old, that people are apt to start thinking, well, it's the same old blah, blah, blah. But I am constantly astounded at Diana's mind. You know, she's a wonderful intellect, and I love to hear what she has to say. And we never run out of things to talk about. The other is that the actual thing of saying, I love you, which I do every morning, is extremely important. And that immediately starts the day with a bit of a smile, no matter what. And if you're in the middle of a disagreement, which all couples have, you could come up with something like, have you ever thought of the erotic capabilities of a parsnip? What? Then you get a laugh, you see. And the other thing is that I find that we have unspoken agreements, which are that we don't say, you never, never say that. Or you always, never say that. And never make any reference to the other person's family. You're just like your, because that is out completely. And what else? That's about, that kind of keeps things on an even keel most of the time. I like her as well. She's a great friend. So that's my marriage anyway. And loving, keep loving. That's all there is to it. I mean, we hug and we kiss and make love, and it's great.